so far.
Good morning, everyone. I am Asha Bala, Executive Director of Leela Foundation. I'm delighted that you can join us for the first program in the Legacy series. Through this series, we intend to bring artists, scholars, writers, poets, and academicians to give us a deeper insight into their area of expertise. We begin the Legacy series with an introduction to contemporary dance. The discussion that will be interspersed with archival video clippings will be led by Dr. Naima Prebo and will be moderated by Janet Lilly. A graduate of Brooklyn College and the Juilliard School of Dance, Dr. Naima Prebo performed with artists like Merce Cunningham and a variety of other artists. During her 38 career as professor at American University, she produced many concerts before turning her attention to criticism and writing. She has written many articles and reviews, and her books have been widely used as resources. Dancing in the Sun, Hollywood Choreographers, 1915 to 1937, American Pageantry, A Movement for Art and Democracy, Dance for Export, Cultural Diplomacy, and the Cold War are just some of her few publications. Dr. Prebo has served on many national and international boards and has been active in both national and international consulting. She is the recipient of many awards, including the most recent in 2019, the Lifetime Achievement Award from the National Dance Education Organization. She currently teaches courses for the certificate program of the NDEO and is consulting for a graduate program in Israel. Welcome, Naima, and thank you.
Good morning.
Moderating the session is Janet Lilly, who is the director of the School of Dance at the University of North Carolina, Greensboro. She was a former principal dancer and teacher with the Bilty Jones and Arnie Zane Company. Lilly joined UNCG in 2011 after over 15 years at the Peck School of Arts, Department of Dance at the University of Milwaukee, Wisconsin, where she was instrumental in creating a low residency MFA program for returning dance professionals. Awarded a 2008-2009 Fulbright Lecturer Fellowship at the Savitri Bai Phule University in Pune, India, Lilly has choreographed and taught as a guest artist and master teacher on college campuses in the United States and abroad. Thank you, Janet, for moderating this session.
Thank you so much, Asha.
Providing technical support are our in-house team of Muthu and Nikita Parmar. Assisting them is Alan Buck, director of the post-baccalaureate program and assistant professor of communications at Meredith College in North Carolina. Thank you to all of you. With that, I will hand it over to Janet now.
Thank you so much, Asha, and everyone for being here. Dr. Prevost has put together a really fascinating presentation for you today. And it's interesting for me as a contemporary dancer because the field is so broad, and she's done a wonderful job of sort of bringing it all together in a way that I hope will be interesting and informative to you. Asha, this is an amazing program, this idea of the legacy to bring all of these different aspects of our amazing field of dance to your school and beyond. And I also want to take a moment to really thank again her technical team, who have been amazing. The amount of detail and time that they've put in to bring this presentation to you is wonderful. So thank you again for that. Acting as your moderator, I will be coming in after the presentation points. So there'll be little breaks in between. We really want this session to be very informative, but also to hear your input and questions, because that will make the experience only richer for all of us. The way that will work is after Naima has done her introduction, and then you've seen the video clip, I'll be coming back on to ask some questions. And the way we'll do that is you have two choices, because I know Zoom is kind of weird. So which one works best for you, whichever one is more comfortable, you can either raise your hand, which you do in your participants area of the Zoom page. And I have you over here to my right, so I can see, I see a nice little blue hand come up when you would like to ask a question. And then I will direct it to you. For example, I might say, Jyoti, can you please unmute yourself and ask your question? If you would prefer, and of course, when you ask your question, you unmute and then you have to mute again, because otherwise it gets really noisy for all of us. But the other option is for you to use the chat feature, which is also in the bottom of your toolbar. And I will see your chat over to the right, and I will read your question. And the question will be answered by Naima, myself, perhaps others. And then I'll also be keeping an eye on the time, so we make sure we get through all of the content. So that's sort of how we'll proceed. We really want to hear your input. Please feel free to ask anything that comes to your mind. And I do have some guiding questions, as does Naima. And at the end, we'll have the opportunity to wrap. So thank you again for being here. And I look forward to talking to you more throughout the presentation.
Thank you, Janet. I think it's my turn, am I right? Welcome, everyone. It's so wonderful to have this program. And we are going to be watching together five videos of American contemporary choreographers. But I want to give you some historical background to let you know how we arrived at this point in 2020 and how we can understand better what we'll be watching. Let us go back to 1870, the period 1870 to 1914. Many, many changes were taking place in society. The historians call 1870 the date of the second Industrial Revolution. And during this period, we see very interesting new inventions and very important: the telephone, the telegraph, the automobile, the plane. We see new uses of energy, gas, oil, electricity. We also see changes in government, and I will give you two examples. In France, we have the Third Republic and the Second Empire collapsing. And then in Russia, we have 1905, the first Russian Revolution, where we're trying to eliminate, they're trying to eliminate the monarchy. And by 1917, the Second Russian Revolution, where we have communism. This is a very different world than the world before. New inventions, new forms of government, attempts to not have monarchy, getting in a car and so forth. Well, artists reacted. Artists said, we can't do the same old things anymore. We want to do new things. And one example of this are the visual artists in France, for instance. We know Monet, Manet, Cézanne created Impressionism, not because they wanted to create necessarily something with a new name, but they wanted to look at the world differently. Well, in dance, we had the same thing happening. And I'm going to ask, we took to put up the two pictures of Isadora Duncan and Ruth St. Denis. Okay, in dance, we had two great revolutionaries who said, wait a minute, the world is changing. We want dance to change. We don't want to do the same old things. We don't want to have the restrictions of ballet with toe shoes and tight costumes and fancy spectacles. We want to be able to express ourselves in this new world with all the changes. Isadora Duncan, you see her there with her arms raised and a loose flowing costume. You can't see the bare feet because we haven't shown that in the picture. And Ruth St. Denis also, flowing costume, outreached arms. These were passionate women, rebels in their personal lives and rebels in movement. They wanted to explore everything. They wanted freedom. They did not want to abide by the old rules. They were changing their art form because society was changing. They were very charismatic women and they performed all over America and very heavily in Europe. They began to be influencers on other artists. not just audiences watching them, but other artists. That Isadora Duncan was painted by many great artists, for instance, Rodin, and Ruth St. Denis was painted by artists. And they left a very strong mark on the dance world. They even influenced ballet choreographers. The very famous ballet Russe, led by Serge Diaghilev, which left Russia after the revolution, the first revolution, and moved to Paris. Choreographers were very influenced by more generally Isadora Duncan, but also Ruth St. Denis. And they started creating ballets that were very, very different from Swan Lake and Nutcracker and Sleeping Beauty. Now, Isadora Duncan had several schools in several places in America, and her sister ran a school in Berlin. And there are still people who do the Isadora Duncan choreography. One famous ballet choreographer, Frederick Ashton, honored her by doing a solo that was based on Duncan. Let's turn to Ruth St. Denis. Excuse me. She created with her husband, Ted Shawn, a school in California called Denishawn. Let's move to the next two pictures of Martha Graham and Doris Humphrey. Martha Graham and Doris Humphrey were both students of Denishawn. Now, the important thing here is that when Isadora Duncan and Ruth St. Denis started being revolutionaries and rebels, they gave a name to what they were doing. We started calling it modern dance. And many people say these were the mothers. Duncan and St. Denis were the mothers of modern dance. And I suppose you could say that Martha Graham and Doris Humphrey were the next generation of mothers. They were modern dancers who created very specific vocabularies and ways of moving. The torso is important, the arm is important, the free-flowing costumes, the restrictions from the toe shoes, the restrictions from the stories of the ballets. Both of these women had many, many students and developed many followers. Graham created very heavy psychological ballets, such as Seraphic Dialogue about Joan of Arc, and she used the Greek myths, but she did them with her own perspective. And she developed a technique which used the torso a great deal in contraction and release. Doris Humphrey didn't deal so much in the psychological, but did a lot of very strong, powerful dances. And she developed a technique called release technique. Now, these women were modern dancers who influenced other modern dancers for many years. The main work that Graham did was from the 20s through the, let's say, the 60s, and Humphrey died earlier, so her work was mainly from the 30s, 40s, and 50s. And they had very strong schools and a very strong following. Let's let go of these two pictures and move on to the 1960s, where we had another rebellion. By the 1960s, society again was changing. And I want to emphasize that dancers, artists of all kinds are always integral to how society is changing and how they feel about society's changes and how they want to express that. So while we have Duncan and St. Denis rebels against the traditions of the 19th century, and then we have Graham and Humphrey rebelling along with Duncan and St. Denis. By the 1960s, new issues come up. We have civil rights, we have women's rights, we have gay rights. We have many, many changes, and dancers said, no, never mind. I'm not gonna do what Martha Graham did. I'm not gonna do what Doris Humphrey did. I'm not gonna do what Isadora Duncan did. I wanna do different things. I wanna dance in the streets. I wanna be able to run and skip and walk if I want. I wanna be able to wear jeans and not a flowing costume. I wanna be able to use text in different ways. They were rebelling in many different ways, and from modern dancers, we now have postmodern dance. This is true in all the arts. We had postmodern art, music, architecture. Actually, the movement started with architecture. And some of the very important names in the postmodern dance field are Lucinda Childs, Tricia Brown, Yvonne Rainer. We are now about the year 2000. So from the 1960s through about 2000, I would say postmodernism was very, very strong with lots of experiments, people rejecting what Martha Graham did, what Doris Humphrey did, finding their own new ways. By the turn of the century, that begins to change a little bit. And that's why I say we have to call now what we do contemporary dance, because all of the changes that went on before have been absorbed. Today we have choreographers using ballet, modern, postmodern, many forms of culturally specific or ethnic dance, hip hop forms, rap music. The field has opened up. I think that you can't really put a label of modern or postmodern on the videos we will be watching today. I'd say the word contemporary really takes care of that. So now that we've leaped through the history, a brief history of trying to explain how the modern dance came about with the rebellion, and then how postmodern dance came about with the rebellion against modern dance. And now today we have contemporary dance, where I would say that many, many different ideas from the modern and the postmodern and other forms are now integrated. I'd like to start watching our videos, and we're going to be watching the first one. And the first one we will watch is actually the oldest dance in this present today. We are going to be watching Alvin Ailey's choreography and the piece that he created, Revelations. We'll be watching a section. It was choreographed in 1960, and today is the 60th anniversary of that work. Revelations is a work that's been performed all over the world. And in fact, the Ailey Company performs it just about every time they perform. And in today's New York Times, there's an article about Revelations. In Revelations, Ailey, as an African-American choreographer, was looking back at his heritage. And I thought it was important for us today to watch this in light of the Black Lives Matter movement and the issues. Ailey looked at his heritage in slavery, in poverty, in deprivation, but he also looked at it with hope and community. We will be watching a section of Revelations called Wade in the Water, and the title comes from the spiritual that accompanies the dance. Slaves escaped through water so that the dogs would lose their scent. I hope that you can see some of the metaphors and symbolism that Ailey uses in this excerpt, Wade in the Water. And one of Janet mentioned, as we were talking earlier, that it's also interesting to point out that Ailey's influenced by Graham, and you will see some of the use of the torso in contraction and release in this work. Ailey didn't specifically study African dance, but he did have that heritage, and he studied with Lester Horton, who was also a very great pioneer. Let's watch Wade in the Water, Alvin Ailey's work.
Thank you, Naima. Can everyone hear me okay? I hope you can. All right, so now you know, one thing, if you would like to go back and look at these, all of these videos are only about a minute and a half long. So we can go back and dig in there a little bit deeper. If maybe you think, oh, I didn't see that. Maybe you get this only caught up in the beautiful dress that one woman was wearing or the umbrella, you know. But my first question to you is, did anyone notice? And again, you can respond by either going into chat or putting up your participant, wave your hand, raise your hand thing. Did anyone notice any references on the stage or in the movement that made you think about water, the movement of water? And did anyone notice that or see that? Okay, I'm looking.
Somebody has raised their hand. Janet, I think I saw a hand raised.
Here's someone. Charlene is saying she saw the movements were very reminiscent of water waves. So you saw perhaps, Charlene and others, how that was not only in the arms, but also in the torso itself, the way the movement was traveling through the body. What about that cloth thing that was being waved around on the stage? What about that? What could have that been? Is this an obvious question? Maybe let's take a little, let's look at that again. So let's go back and look again, if we could, Muktu, at that whole bit. And this time, look specifically for two things. So look for the water, all right? So that's interesting because in contemporary dance, there may not be only one meaning. So Naima pointed out quite brilliantly how this reflected the slaves escaping from the south into the north through the water of a river, perhaps. Also, Revelations as a whole, this is only one section of the piece. So as a whole, the piece is maybe 30, 40 minutes long, and it has many other representations of this particular community, which is also largely informed by the life in the church. So you see also the idea of baptism, perhaps, and that when they take the religion in this particular religious practice, so you might see some baptism or other religious community-based ideas. So if we could take one more look, Mukta, at this, please. Thank you. So sometimes it's good to just go back and look at it again, because your first impression is it's the stage, the movement, it's the costumes, it's the fabric, but there are so many other layers of meaning in there. Did anybody else have, oh yes, Asha?
So I know these are all, this is called a contemporary dance, but is it more old school as compared to the newer works that are coming on now? I don't know if that's the term to be used, but
I was going to say that, Asha, thank you, because actually this is the oldest thing that we're watching, and Ailey was definitely in the modern dance tradition. There's a lot of emotional, psychological material in Revelations about how he felt and looked back at his heritage. And it's classical modern dance. He's using the torso. There's some Graham influences. There's some influences of a little bit of ballet. Ailey would be labeled a modern dancer. He comes from that background and from that period. And it's a coherent theatrical piece, which is also very common for the modern dancers. They're not doing the spectacles of ballet. They rejected those, but they're doing other kinds of content related things. And I think another issue here is that the Revelations is not a sad dance. The content is difficult. It deals with the deprivation and the slavery, but in abstract terms, and he's giving, as Janet said, through the church, there's a message of hope that through community and through coming together, we can form a better life for ourselves. But we do have to remember that our life was not always good. So there is an interest, I think there's work by African-American choreographers that's harder, that has more conflict, and that is not quite in that this tradition. But you're right, Asha, he would be a modern dancer.
So modern as against postmodern and contemporary?
I would say modern as against postmodern. Janet,
I would say modernism as a forerunner to postmodernism.
Yeah.
And now I see we actually do have, I realize now I'm not a host, so I can't see hands being raised. And I don't know if we're able to do that, but we do have two hands being raised. Somebody was kind enough. Thank you, Jamie and Barnaby, for letting me know that someone had raised their hands. I did want to, before we go to the two questions that have come up, I also wanted to reiterate something else. So when you look at the movement, you see how the dancers were trained. And you know this from your own traditions. So within the Ailey School, the dancers learn a wide range, because most of the company members come from the Ailey School, a wide range of styles. They learn Martha Graham technique, as Naima talked about earlier. They learn Lester Horton technique, another early modern dance forerunner. They also learn Catherine Dunham technique, which was another very important dancer who was also an anthropologist from the University of Chicago, who went to Haiti to learn forms there. And you see her in some of the polyrhythmic body movement in that piece. They also learn other things like ballet and many other things. So the contemporary dancer, which, as Asha's question was, they're performing a legacy modern dance work, but Ailey dancers are really trained as contemporary dancers in all of these other forms, so that they have this wide palette of movement possibilities for the choreographer. Now, let's see. Arushi, did you have a question? Would you like to unmute yourself?
It was more of an observation, but you were talking about like how if you saw any movements that kind of reminded you of the water. One thing I noticed in the beginning when they were walking across the two clothing, it looked like they were literally wading across the water, and the big steps kind of looked like that. Like they were, you know how in water it's harder to move, so the movements are similar to that. And then another thing I noticed was as the water levels, or like the cloth actually went higher, their movements got a little faster as well.
Yes. You know, it's funny because I've seen this piece so many times, and this today for the first time, I could say, oh yeah, that's water, that's a river, But then I had that moment when I was watching them, just like you, take that step. And I was like, oh my goodness, that's what it feels like when I'm trying to walk into the ocean or the river, and there's that sort of pull on your legs. It's captured so beautifully. Lovely observation. Thank you, Arushi. And Dia, did you have an observation as well, or question, comment?
Yes, mine was an observation as well. It was kind of in the same vein as some of the others who spoke about their observations, but I was watching the push and pull of the torso movements, and to me that represented kind of like the tides, and it kind of symbolized strength to me, like what they were fighting against, kind of like that strength they were putting into their torso going back and forth. That's what kind of jumped out at.
Great observation. Thank you so much, everyone. And I'm glad you're all jumping in here and you have some comments and
great
observations. We're going to move on to the next
Naima. Yeah, fantastic observations. And every time you see a piece, you see different things. And that's wonderful and exciting. And good choreography does that. I have chosen, aside from the Ailey, everyone, he passed away in 1989. All the other four choreographers that we're going to watch are still alive and still very active, and the pieces that we're going to watch are much more recent. And I think if I could share my excitement when I see these pieces and when I chose them, how amazing it is that each choreographer does something different. And the music is different, the bodies are used differently, the ideas are different. The choreographers are trying to have their individual expressiveness and voice. they're all working with their craft. They all know how to choreograph. They all know, they've studied extensively, but they're all different. The next piece is by Mark Morris, and it's Falling Downstairs, and it was choreographed in 1994, and it's a collaboration with the great cellist, Yo-Yo Ma, who's playing J.S. Bach's unaccompanied suite number 3 for unaccompanied cello. There's no story here. There's really no, it's very different from the Ailey. There's no content except pure movement. Watch and see how he has the individual bodies move, what parts of the bodies are moving, where are the accents. Watch and see how he plays with the stairs. Now that is a legacy from postmodernism a little bit, because there was an emphasis on pedestrian movement, everyday movement. So there's a little bit of that in Morris. Watch how he moves the groups around, the use of space, the enormous use of space. Watch it with joy, because it's, this is, there's something on the screen, I don't know what that is. Watch how Morris uses the music. One of the things about Mark Morris is that he's always uses live music. So we're going to listen to Yo-Yo Ma, watch Mark Morris's dancers, and see what you see in terms of how he uses the body, how he uses the space, how he uses the music. So let's watch Mark Morris Falling Downstairs.
Thank you, Naima. All right, so that's our second choreographer. And as Naima mentioned, so the first piece you saw was from 1960. This is now over 30 years later, right? 60 to 90,
yeah,
30, I think.
94 years.
Double checking, good morning.
34 years.
And in this work, maybe you noticed that there's some similarities. And to go back to Asha's earlier question, Mark Morris is, for us, or I would think of as a contemporary dancer, not only because of when he's making work, but the things he's thinking about in making the work. However, we see a lot of connections in the movement to modern dancing, what we think about modern dancing, beyond the use of, you know, not wearing shoes or something like that. It's something about the weightedness or the groundedness in the movement. You see the dancers jump, but there's a real connection to the floor. And thinking back to one of the things Naima was saying earlier about ballet, some of the early modern dancers said, you know, when I look at ballets, they've, particularly in the role of women, a woman is a swan, a woman is a dragonfly, a woman is some ghost come back to haunt her naughty lover. I mean, the woman becomes all these other things, but when is the woman, a human, a person? And so a lot of the early modern dancers say, we don't want to be dragonflies anymore and swans and jilted lovers. We want to be human women dancing. So you see this really in Mark Morris's movement, that fullness and that humanity of it. Another thing Mark Morris is known for is his musicality, which is sometimes very surprising. So you see him working with classical music. So again, similar to Revelations, Falling Downstairs is a long work. There's many Bach cello solo suites, as some of you may know, And there's many different sections of this work. So in terms of how he worked with music, because he also conducts, he can conduct, and he works with opera and classical music and all sorts of things. Did you notice any interesting or surprising moments that the way the music aligned with the steps you saw the dancers doing? And again, I'm not sure that I can see hands here, so it might be better if you put it in a chat, if you have a comment, anyone. So I'm scrolling here. Does anyone see anything that they thought, or do you want to see it again? We probably have time.
I think we can, yeah.
Yeah, that would be helpful. So let's look at it. Look for the alignment, and you may look at this in terms of in relationship to how you align your dance choreography to music. So if we could see this one more time, Mutuk, thank you. Thank you. So what about that moment when they're going up and down the stairs on the same notes as the cello? Maybe you noticed that. That's kind of a surprising moment. Did anyone see anything else?
I think there's someone.
Okay. Unmute yourself and then we can hear you.
I liked the collab of the cello with the hasty movements that they had in their bodies. So there's continuously something happening probably in a square or a town. I mean, I could see some hasty movements in the bodies.
Thank you. I see that Isha noted that what I felt was that the movements were really following the music. And notice the heaviness and the groundedness in the movement. Isha, would you like to speak to that a moment or more, what you saw in that, or give an example?
You can. I felt that if that cello was going like that,
yeah,
the dancers were going, you know, it was really matching that flow of the music. And you know, that I really loved that movement of that, which was, I really loved the heaviness of that movement.
Great, thank you, Isha. And I don't know, I see also that Arushi and Charlene have something to note, but another thing that, you know, just, I know this about Morris's work, but sometimes when you have the chance to sort of just slow down and watch it, he has a background in Eastern European, particularly Bulgarian folk dance, is what he studied as a young person when he was, you know, junior high or high school. And you see that kind of like in the circle forms, the way the dancers create a circle there towards the end. You see him bringing back some of these forms that you might recognize from folk dance forms into the choreography. Let's see, Arusha, yes, the dips. So I'm going to read some of these. When there are dips in the music, the movement dips. The movements flow with the momentum of the music. And from Charlene, this was a little more abstract for me, but it was interesting to see the alternating twists and turns of the dancers in the circle. There's the circle, aligning with the accents of the dancers in the movement. Thank you. And Radha noted there was a repetition in the choreography that reflected the repetition in the music. The accented notes of the music corresponded with the up accents of the dancers' movement. And finally, Kala notes that there's an interesting use of quick and slow time and an exploration of space. Yes, you see how they just really like dive out into the space around them and traverse through the space quite physically and boldly. These were great observations, everyone. Thank you. Let's move on to
Let me just say that sometimes people criticize Morris for being so close to the music, but he's also creating, as you people in your observations noted, very interesting dynamics in the bodies themselves. So you have the quiet moments and you have the busy moments and you have the accented moments. And you have a lot of repetition, which is actually a mark of good choreography, usually, that the artist is a craftsperson and knows how to repeat the material, but sometimes with differences in how it's repeated. So, okay, let's move to the next artist, Benjamin Millepied. And it was very clear to me that I wanted different music and different choreography and different use of the body. Millepied comes from a ballet background. He was trained in ballet. He performed with the New York City Ballet, and he was director of dance at the Paris Opera. But he is, I would say, Asha, this is really an example of a contemporary choreographer or a contemporary ballet choreographer, however you want to say it. He is not doing classical ballet, but there are hints of it. There is no story here. This is a pas de deux, a duet, which is just about two bodies moving. And the music is by a contemporary composer, Philip Glass, very different from the Bach. How does Millepied use the music? How do the dancers work with this music? I don't know how many of you are familiar with the music of Philip Glass. He's quite well known and he's done a great deal of composing. There are many contemporary dancers who use his music. So we have, this work was choreographed in 2006. It's quite recent, by Benjamin Millepied to the music of Philip Glass, and it's called Closer. Again, these are all excerpts, as Janet pointed out. These are not the full pieces. There's something called intellectual property rights where we can't show and they can't do on a website the full piece. So we're getting excerpts, but hopefully these excerpts tell you something about how the choreographer works. Let's watch Benjamin Millepied Closer.
Sorry, I think I accidentally clicked somebody else's box. So, sorry, Isha, I think it was you. I got so caught up in that beautiful dancing. Oh my goodness. Let's go back to that other comment I made earlier. That woman, she wasn't a dragonfly or a swan, was she? Mm-mm. No, that was a woman dancing with a man, and they were dancing so beautifully the way they were interconnected together. another thing to think about when we keep coming back to this theme of, well, how is this contemporary ballet? What, how is it different from modern contemporary dance? And we start to find that these boundaries are getting a little blurry. Yeah. And that's what's so interesting about our world now, because we share so much and we start to see how the work is being influenced. But I guess I would like to sort of reach out to you as the viewers looking at this. How do you feel that mille-pieds, which doesn't that mean 1,000 feet in French?
Yes, mille-pieds.
Okay, so.
And he is French by origin.
He is French. So how did he use music? What are some of the similarities or differences you may have seen with how he used the music between Bach, which is what Mark Morris just used, and Philip Glass? So this is a funny thing. I mean, so Bach, what's his, like, he's back there in the Baroque age, long, long time ago. And then here we have Philip Glass composing music in our times. So did anyone have any observations in similarities or differences in terms of how the music was used by the choreographer or danced to by the dancers? So that's your question for this one. Here we go. So Harin, would you like to, instead of having me read it, how about you tell us what you saw? So if you could unmute yourself, that would be great. Thank you.
I saw that there were some movements that were matching up with the music, like the previous composition. But unlike the previous composition, there were also a lot of movements that were more expressive and almost told a story, kind of.
Yes. So there was, I mean, I was noticing when I was watching, I don't know if anybody else saw this, I went, my goodness, they're never going to separate for more than 2 seconds. They were constantly intertwined and re-intertwined and finding new ways to connect and new ways for him to support her or take her into space or through space. There in the end, they separate. It's quite dramatic, isn't it? Kala, this is interesting. Let's talk about this because that is an interesting perspective. Would you like to tell us a little bit about what you saw there?
Yeah, no, just like I said, I was just uncomfortable with the amount of control that he yielded. And then, he had, and of course, there are different ways of looking at it, whether there was a symbiosis there and then a separateness, or it would have been interesting to see further, where the choreography went with that. But just perhaps this little piece, just a little bit, I was uncomfortable with that. But this is this is something that repeats across choreography, so this is not the only one.
Interesting, Kala. I want Naima to maybe comment on that. But one thing I thought was interesting, because, you know, in ballet, like if you watch more historical ballet, sometimes it's like it's very legible. You can say, oh, chasse, pas de bourrée, fourth position, they're going to set up to do some pirouettes here. It's like we're always getting the lead in to what's going to happen next. And then there's been this relationship between men and women in ballet in the past in which the man is there to show off the woman. Like I think Balanchine famously said, ballet is woman, right? So what is, yeah, it can be an uncomfortable relationship in terms of how we read it from our contemporary perspective. Naima, do you have any?
I've watched this and I think that it's not so much the man just holding on to the woman and she's giving in to him. I get the feeling from this, she's independent also. To me, she's an independent mover and person. They come together, but she moves him and he moves her. Maybe because I've seen more of the piece, but I think we also tend to watch these things assuming that the woman can be much more distinct and much more different, and sometimes not seeing that this interdependency is also a creative thing for the woman. This is, to me, this is not the woman just being some toy at the behest of the man. To me, she has an independent personality. She goes inside out, she goes upside down, she pushes, she pulls. So I see a lot of independence. Maybe not as much as someone would like, I don't think, but it's not a statement about two people. It's about movement to me. It's about all the possibilities that exist. It could be two women also. I mean, I think this could be done with two women. It could be done with two men. I don't think that the duets that we're used to seeing in ballet could be done with two women or two men normally. So that's my thoughts on it. I don't know about Janet or anyone else, but.
Yeah, I think it's an interesting perspective to note. Thank you for sharing that, Kala. Naima, shall we go on to the next one?
The next video is choreography by Kyle Abraham, who is also an African-American choreographer. This was Inventing Pookie Jenkins, choreographed in 2006. Kyle Abraham is very well known for his political and social statements in dance. He has a very well-known piece called Pavement, where he looks at gangs and police and violence in the underserved African-American communities. He's done other works like that. He has choreographed for the Alvin Ailey Company. And in a way, and we did this, in Janet and was mentioning this when we were discussing these, we can go back to Ailey. These are two African-American choreographers from very different periods. Kyle Abraham uses rap music for this work, the work of Dizzy Rascal. And he's bringing together many different elements. There's rap, there's hints of Swan Lake, there's hints of Martha Graham, there's hints of Ailey. This is called Inventing Pookie Jenkins. And I was told by an African-American student of mine that Pookie means adolescent. It meant that in his family. And so this is, to me, is about a man, and he's a gay man, trying to find out who he is, struggling with his identity, struggling with the space around him, the space inside him, and not quite sure what emerges as his final statement. But we see him moving in many different ways. The arms create great emphasis, the torso creates great emphasis. There are a lot of levels. So look at this as he's a very contemporary, this is definitely a contemporary choreographer, and this is a very relatively recent piece, which is considered one of Kyle Abraham's signature pieces. So let's watch the Kyle Abraham choreography.
Now it's Harini. I've tried to unmute. Okay, I'll unmute myself this time. All right, great. So looking at this one, I'm going to give you two things to reflect on. And as before, you know, if we want to go back and look at it again, we can, because there's a lot to look at there. There's a lot to see. There's a lot of juxtaposition, meaning different ideas sort of coming up against each other simultaneously, happening at the same time there. So the two things perhaps you could reflect on, our dear viewers, the first one would be, how do you see gesture? And by that, I mean primarily hand gestures that you might see reference from popular culture, from hip hop artists, et cetera. How do you see the use of gesture here being used differently or similarly to, if you can remember back to Alvin Ailey, walking in the water, the baptism gesture, moving the body in the water. So that would be one question or thought you might want to think about. And the second would be, how do you think his choice of a costume in this piece affects how you view the dance? So you have two things to think about. Naima gave you a little bit of a hint there when she was talking about Swan Lake. You see him go down and sort of bow over his foot. That's a direct reference from the ballet Swan Lake. So we're sort of coming full circle here between Alvin Ailey and the gestural language there. And then also the what we were talking about with ballet and the differences between contemporary ballet and what we see here. So any thoughts? I think the chat's working good for me, even though they did make me a co-host. I'm still not seeing blue hands. So go ahead and put your comments in the chat, and I'd love to have you talk to us about what you're seeing.
So was it more tongue in cheek, the way he was using the costume, the ballet costume and the movements, or was it, what was there something else in the way he was using it? And of course, it's so self-indulgent, many of the choreographies are.
Right. So thank you, Asha. Let's talk about that for a moment, Naima. And Kala, we do see that your hand is up. So we'll go to you next. So when I saw this the other night, actually, when we were doing our sort of rehearsal for this event, I said, he's wearing a romantic ballet tutu. I mean, I remember this from like ballet history class. This is what Maria Tallonier or Fanny Esther would have worn when I looked at the lithographs of them from the day. So, but he's wearing it down low, right? It's down low and there's this bare torso. So what is he referencing? I think that's actually exactly the question he wants you to ask.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, he's to me, and I think this can be interpreted many different ways, but to me, he's saying, I have male and female components to me. I am struggling with who I am and what I am, but there's a feminine part of me and a masculine part of me. And the feminine and masculine sometimes work together and sometimes don't. But there's a sense of struggle for me. And there's a sense of struggle, but there's also a sense of calm in this piece. It's a very mixed piece, I think. It's, to me, beautifully performed and very interesting. I've watched it many times, and there's always something new that I see in terms of what he's trying to say about himself, and also the sense of the space that he's in a confined space. I think how choreographers use space is important. Mark Morris is all over. It's this joyful use of space, and for me, the Bach has that sense of space too. Here, the wrap is tight, and the movement's tight, and is he feeling confined? Is he feeling like he'd like to break out of it? Sometimes he sort of breaks out of it when he changes level. So I think those are some things that are interesting in the piece. There were some comments that...
Yeah, Arushi and Dia both point out that sort of tension in the skirt and how that has some internal struggle, perhaps it represents that. And then also Dia goes on to say, oh, wait, and Smita has a good one. Okay, but first, we don't want to ignore Kala. So let's just go to Kala for a moment, and then we'll come back to our chat box. Kala.
I'm sorry. I just raised my hand because it was just too much to type, long sentence. But I found this really interesting and fascinating because from the costume point of view, the fact that the movements, for example, were both a very great combination of linear, straight, direct, and also like the shaping, the flow, the circular, and the costume added to that, giving that circle, and gave that shaping sort of. So the great combination of the two and the tension between the two was just fascinating. I want to see more of it. It's really good, really good piece.
Absolutely. Thank you, Kala. And Asmita Prasad, would since I'm not sure of this concept in Bharatanatyam, perhaps you could unmute yourself and tell us a little bit about what you're seeing there.
Absolutely. So in Bharatanatyam, and Asha, please correct me, you know, where I'm not going to be quite accurate. But I think we have this concept of Ardhanarishvara, right? Which is essentially, it says every human being is not just, you know, male or female, but we have shades of this. It's a spectrum. How much we have, you know, the interplay in a person between Shiva and Shakti, you know, man and woman, male and female. I think it's sort of, it reminded me of that similar concept that we've got. So that's, I think that's just what I wanted to comment.
That's fascinating. Thank you.
That's one thing I've always loved in Bharatanatyam. Like sometimes they'll just that step, someone will be doing one character facing downstage right, take some steps upstage, come back, turn downstage left, and then they're another character that, you know, could be a god, could be a woman, could be a man. It's a beautiful, beautiful expression of character in that dance form. I really appreciate it. I'm so glad you pointed that out, Smita. Okay, so Naima, would we like to go on to our final?
Yes, we have our last video. I hope that as we finish with the last one, you're seeing the enormous range of possibilities in choreography today and in movement, and seeing some of the different things that come into play for the choreographers, the different music, the different use of music, the different use of space, body, sometimes content, sometimes no content. And Pam Tanowitz is very different again from the others. The title, this is the most recent work, choreographed in 2016. And Pam Tanowitz has gotten very, very well known. She has choreographed for the Royal Ballet, for New York City Ballet. She's for doing a lot of work. This became an interesting discussion when we rehearsed, that I brought up four important women in the development of modern dance. And I said how important they were. And then I came to Pam Tanowitz and I said, unfortunately, women have not played a role as choreographers. What I'm saying is that in regular ballet companies, women were not acknowledged as independent choreographers. Martha Graham, Ruth St. Denis, Isadora Duncan, Doris Humphrey were independent women who created their own companies. They were not asked to do works for New York City Ballet or American Ballet Theatre. Here is a contemporary choreographer whose work is not at all like any ballet, and yet she is doing work for many ballet companies now. So I find that very interesting. And they are in fact supporting more women to do work in these established companies. So you have to realize that the modern dancers were independent folks. They created their own companies. They worked with their own companies. Today, the picture is a little bit different. A lot of ballet companies are commissioning some of these contemporary artists. Kyle Abraham may seem way out there to some people, but he's doing work for ballet companies. So that's it's interesting. Anyway, the work by Pam Tanowitz is called The Story Progresses as If in a Dream of Glittering Surfaces. She doesn't have a specific meaning for this. This is, again, not a story. This is pure movement. And I think her movement is quite different from some of the other works that you saw. She's using the music of a contemporary composer, Dan Siegler. And I'd like you to watch the silences, the dynamics, the males, the male and female relationships and movements, the coming together, the going apart, lots of small things to watch here, some bigger things. Let's watch Pam Tanowitz.
Thank you.
Good, I got it right that time. Great. I thank you, Kala. I saw your note, and thank you. She's asked that we share again the titles and names of the work that Naima has done such a beautiful job putting together for this presentation, and we can certainly do that. COVID's a weird time, but a great thing about COVID is that there's a lot of available now. So for example, Pam Tanowitz, the last choreographer you saw, the Joyce Theater in New York City, is doing her season. And my husband has bought a ticket for $12 or something, and he has 4 days to watch, and he's watching it constantly. I'm like, Mark, what are you doing now? Oh, I'm watching Pam Tanowitz again. So the work is out there and available. And I really do hope you have some time to go back and look at these works again. And since this is our last one, I just want to take a moment to acknowledge how beautifully Naima has put together and structured this presentation and shown you.
Well, you've been such an amazing moderator.
No, what a joy. It's a really, really hard thing to do because there is so much work out there, and we kind of go down a bit of a rabbit hole when we start to look at it all because there's so much available to see. In this last work, I just want to make one comment. I think you may have all perhaps heard of Merce Cunningham. He comes out from that earlier modern dance lineage. And some people will align Pam Tanowitz's aesthetic, the last choreographer we just saw, to his. There's a certain linear aspect to the movement. Sometimes it looks as if it's ballet legs. You see the steps that maybe you recognized in Millepied's work. On the bottom, but then there's this very linear contemporary modern dance upper body. You see some of that. It might be interesting if you're thinking about, Naima asked that we look at how the dancers are connecting or not connecting. How would you look at the relationship between the man and the woman in the short duet segment you saw here and what we saw with Millepied? They don't really touch. There's space between, is that COVID? No, this is pre-COVID.
Pre-COVID.
So thinking a little bit about, just two comments for you to reflect on here. How are these dancers relating in space would be one aspect to look at. And then finally, sort of coming back to an earlier comment we've been thinking about is what is the relationship of this choreographer and these dancers to the music? Did you see parallels in how they were responding to the music? So those are some comments for you to observe on the floor. And since this is our last example, if you'd also like to reflect on anything from this piece back to the Ailey piece that we started with. So the floor is open. I think I can now see blue hands and also in the chat. So
Janet, another question, overall question, unless you have some.
No, please.
What did watching all five mean to people? What did they get from watching all five in terms of the differences, the similarities, different ways of expression?
Okay. Oh, so Mutuk has given us the links to the videos to everyone if you would like to see them again. I wonder, because I sometimes, we have one down here, we'll look at, that's some more. Going back to Merce Cunningham to reflect on for this piece. So we see these dancers, and Naima has said that there's not a story here, but that doesn't mean there's not meaning. So, for example, one of the things Merce Cunningham was famous for saying is, you can't put human bodies on stage and not have people see meaning in it. It's really not possible. So did you see any connections between these four dancers in the choreography? That would be another question to think. So was this piece different or harder to see than the others? Maybe because there were more bodies on stage, or what? Okay, so how about this? Go ahead, Asha.
Yeah, I was just saying that the movements were certainly more angular and more, as against the flowing movements of Alvin Ailey or even Kyle Abraham. So these were more angular and sharp, mm-hmm. And certainly definitely more contemporary.
And there's, I don't know if you noted, I was commenting on the duets. So, and really thinking about Kala's comments from the Millepied duet, you see, it's Melissa Toogood, I think, who's upstage center with her arms out to the side in an attitude, front leg up and bent, which actually I see in Bharatanatyam, and actually, oh, look, there's Shiva doing it right there. So that front attitude line. And then instead of coming and connecting with her, or she's supporting herself. Mm-hmm. He doesn't even support her, right? Mm-hmm. She's there on one leg, arms out to the side. And he finds a way to connect with what in visual arts you would call the negative space. He sort of inserts his arm in the space between her leg and her arm, but he's not he's not supporting her. The woman is on her own. She's not on her 2 feet, she's on 1 foot, but she's standing on her own 1 foot, one might say, in that moment. Any other thoughts or comments?
Yeah, I think Kala has raised her hand.
Oh, yeah, I just wanted to add to that it almost felt like they were making decisions there on connecting and disconnecting or coming, it almost felt like there was decision-making going on, which is very right. Interesting.
Like a negotiation of shared space.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, yeah.
Well, this was a beautiful work for us to see. And the dancers? Huh. Yes. So Charlene, would you just, as opposed to me reading it, I think it's more effective in your voice. And this is actually your approach is interesting here, because first we look at what we see, right? So perhaps we describe what we're seeing on stage. And then from there, we can find perhaps more meaning within that. So Charlene, if you would just unmute yourself and express to us what you've placed here in the chat box.
Sure. Yeah. And it's hard to explain that in the chat, right? But in the beginning of that last piece, the one dancer off to my left in sort of the silvery pinafore was separate from the group. Mm-hmm. He was dancing almost to her own tune. And she came together, that dancer came together with the group in the middle of at least the piece that we saw. And then towards the end, she broke away again. And she seemed to be, was she being chased by the man in the green? Or, was she, so I was thinking about the difference, back to Kala's comment on the Millepied piece, where the woman seems so intertwined with the man and the movements were so coordinated. It was very interesting to see how different and independent this dancer was in this last piece and the dynamics of, you know, breaking. And it, I guess, Kala, you were saying that it's almost like a decision making going on. You know, do I go with this group? Do I go off on my own? Do I let this man, you know, and the part where she was balancing and the man was, I think you mentioned the negative space, mm-hmm. inserting himself into the negative space is like, okay, I'm allowing you to be a part of my space now. So I was struck by that.
And there's something about that, because a lot of times in choreography, a very effective use of space or people in space is like cause and effect, right? Like, so I do this and then that causes these three people to do that. But there's something very, it's interdependent, but also very independent in the way the dancers are relating to each other in the use of spatial groupings in this piece. I see we have a comment from Setina. Maybe I pronounced that incorrectly. Would you like to tell us what you saw there? Unmute. Setina? I don't know. Okay, I'll go ahead and read it. She saw that it seemed that they were exploring themselves on stage. They were together in the same space, but at the same time having their own individual space. Yes. Great. So this is our final video. And I don't know, Naima, would you like to come in and wrap it up for us in some way?
Oh, I just think that the comments everyone had were so insightful. And I think that it's hard to see something for only a minute and a half to 2 minutes.
And just on video, not
and
live.
Just on video, and also excerpts, not a full piece. So I think people were really tuned in and saw really interesting things. The observations were very good. And I apologize for such a quick and brief overview of 150 years or so, but hopefully some of the names will mean something to you. I know Asha wanted some of you to wanted people to have a sense of the modern dance history and a little bit of the postmodern. But this is just the beginning, I hope, for some of you or all of you. There's lots of good material available now. Actually, lots of people are streaming. And the Jacob's Pillow Archives has lots of things that you can watch. They're all short. So hope you enjoyed and get a chance to watch more and watch again. And thank you, Asha, for having us do this. And Janet, what a wonderful moderator. And our Nikki and Mutuk and Alan just couldn't have been better. What a joy.
Thank you so much, everyone.
And so on behalf of Leela Foundation, my heartfelt gratitude to Naima Prevost, my mentor and professor from American University, and to Janet Lilly. Thank you both for such an amazing introduction to contemporary dance, and we look forward to having you both again to go a little bit deeper into this dance genre. And I just want to take a moment to say that how much Naima has influenced the way I have begun to look at dance, both during my time with her in the class as well as outside. And I wanted to, it's been a pleasure to introduce her to my students so that they get an idea of their dance lineage and their dance legacy. So thank you, Naima, and thank you, Janet, for your wonderful moderation. Thank you so much. And I'd also like to thank our technical team of Muthu and Nikita. And from Meredith College, Alan Buck, thank you so much for being there. And the next program in the Legacy Series will be in March 2021, when we will feature haiku, an experiential form of poetry that is of Japanese origin. It will be presented by a poet, editor, and anthologist, Kala Ramesh. And until then, I hope you will be able to join us for that. And until then, warm greetings to all of you and Happy New Year. Please be safe and thank you once again.
Thank you.